But elsewhere, others were celebrating. The US felt it had won a war without losing a single American soldier. For it was Afghans who had fought on their behalf. Hundreds of thousands had died, and Afghanistan had been left with a shattered economy and government. Would the US take responsibility for Afghanistan in the future? The man who ran the CIA's covert action in the latter part of the war now lives in rural Vermont. He's never spoken publicly about Afghanistan before, and I wanted to ask Tom Twetton about the American post-war plan.
We have a sort of piece of paper in our system, which is called a finding, that's signed by the president. Our finding on the Afghanistan said, push the Russians out, support the Afghans, give them all the support they need. But it didn't say anything about what came next. There was one goal that trumped all others. Help the Afghans defend their soil, kill the Russians. Who was there to do it? They were all Islamists. And we didn't spend much time thinking about, you know, what degree of Islamist is it that we can't tolerate?
Twetton's CIA had avoided the trap of outright occupation, but they had worked within a dangerously narrow and limited vision, funding brutal warlords, men linked to terrorists who would eventually kill thousands across the world. But the first to reap the consequences were not the Americans, but the Afghans themselves. 10 years of Soviet occupation had left Kabul largely intact. But when the Mujahideen seized the capital, they turned on each other, firing rockets from the ridgelines, destroying the very city, and killing the very families they'd fought to liberate. The Civil War, perhaps the very darkest period in Afghan history, lasted for 5 long years.
The Mujahideen leaders transformed. They became brutal warlords, tearing the country apart. The Americans had stopped sending any money or arms. So to fund themselves, the warlords turned to the heroin trade. And they began to export more and more opium to the West. The poppy fields of Helmand became the center of a multi-million dollar business, irrigated by the dams and canals built 40 years before by the American government. Out of the chaos came two extreme and violent reactions. Both ruthlessly simplified the world, and both, although they were completely contradictory, were rooted in Wahhabism, the intolerant fundamentalism that came from Saudi Arabia. One was the Taliban. They started as a group of students in religious schools in Pakistan called madrasas, where many Afghan children had gone to study. They became the core of a revolution that spread rapidly through Afghanistan. Although they were in Pakistan, most of the madrasas had been created over the previous 20 years by money from Saudi Arabia. They were part of the massive effort that had been started by King Faisal to spread fundamentalism throughout the Islamic world. And the ideas that the madrasas taught were very close to Saudi Wahhabism. The Saudi intelligence agencies worked with the CIA to ship arms and money to the Afghan rebels. On the surface, the Saudis did this because a fellow Muslim country had been invaded by communists. But it was also part of their attempt to export the dangerous fundamentalism at the heart of their own society. In 1979, a group of Saudi radicals had taken over the Grand Mosque in Mecca. For 2 weeks, the authorities had fought running battles with the insurgents. They discovered that a number of the attackers had been taught by the most senior religious leader in the country. It made the ruling family realize just how fragile their grip on power was. So as well as sending them money and the weapons, they encouraged young radicals to go and fight in Afghanistan. One of them was a young Osama bin Laden. The aim was to divert their anger. But it meant that with the arms would also come the pessimistic and intolerant version of Islam, Wahhabism. To begin with, these ideas would have little influence in Afghanistan. But they would take hold there and mutate into a dark and violent force that was completely at odds with Reagan's vision of freedom. When the Taliban swept into Kabul, they went to the presidential palace and tore out all painted images of living things, even removing the faces off the stone lions. The society the Taliban built was based on an imagined idea of the past, a recreation of how they thought Islamic society had been run in the 7th century. All modernization was swept away. Women were not to be educated, and all film and music was banned. But for millions of Afghans, Taliban rule was hell. They banned girls from school, forced women to hide even their faces, and they inflicted the most terrifying punishments. And yet the West did not interfere. It wasn't the Taliban's cruelty that led to the next foreign invasion. It was this. The mastermind of 9/11 first came to Afghanistan to fight for Islam against the Soviet Union. He wasn't an Afghan, nor were the 9/11 hijackers, but the Taliban government gave them refuge. Once again, a superpower invaded, and this time with good reason, to get Al-Qaeda. The coalition brought many improvements to Afghanistan, particularly in the early days. But the US soon faced the almost irresistible temptations of empire. Like the Soviets, they were tempted to reshape Afghanistan ever more in their own image. And when the resistance began against them, like Britain and the Soviets before them, the coalition did not want to seem weak. And once again, another superpower and its allies were tracked into investing more and more into Afghanistan.
The dynamic was one of manipulation. They understood how we saw the conflict. They presented their local group conflict, their civil war between groups that had been going on for 35 years. They presented everything in that dynamic. So they came to us and said, those people over there are Taliban. And we went, okay, and we went off and dealt with them. But actually, we were dealing with their previous enemies, so we were just creating more enemies for ourselves. And you ended up in a downward spiral where, because everyone was manipulating us, we ended up fighting everyone. And then in return, everyone who fought us immediately became Taliban. The way that we decided whether you were Taliban or not was whether you were firing at us. Post-2001, whereas we've understood the conflict as good, bad, black, white, government, Taliban, they've understood it as a shifting mosaic of different groups and leaders fighting each other, effectively over power. And the currency of power in Helmand is opium. That's largely what the conflict's about.
In 2009, the presidential elections were held. Hamid Karzai stood and allied himself with some of the most powerful warlords. But there were allegations that the warlords rigged the vote on a massive scale. This was backed up with videos that seemed to show the warlords' followers stuffing the ballot boxes with hundreds of fake voting papers. The coalition tried to rerun the election. But Karzai's main opponent refused, because he said it would be even more corrupt. So the British and the Americans had no choice but to abandon their great dream of a real democracy in Afghanistan. They gave in and allowed Karzai to become president again.
This morning, the Federal Reserve, with support of the Treasury Department, took additional actions to mitigate disruptions to our financial markets. Today's events are fast-moving, but the Chairman of the Federal Reserve and the Secretary of the Treasury are on top of them and will take the appropriate steps to promote stability in our markets.
And at the very same time as their simple plan was falling apart in Afghanistan, the politicians had to face a crisis at home. They had given power to the banks because the bankers and the financial technocrats had promised that they could hold the economy stable. But in 2008, the whole intricate system of credit and loans that the banks had created collapsed. And there was growing panic as giant financial institutions faced bankruptcy. The politicians in America and Britain stepped in and rescued the banks. As they did so, they began to discover that most of the major financial institutions were also riddled with corruption. But unlike President Roosevelt in the 1930s, they didn't then try and reform the system. Instead, they simply propped it up by literally pouring billions more pounds and dollars into the banks, hoping that this would somehow spread through the economies. They had no other idea. And faced by disaster in Afghanistan, the politicians did exactly the same there too. The Americans knew that the idea of democracy was failing. In desperation, they poured even more money into the Afghan economy. The idea was that this would somehow create a simpler economic form of democracy, and that the free market would liberate people. They would become model consumers, following their own rational self-interest, just like in the economies of the West. And in an odd way, it worked. Many of those in charge of the money did behave in their own rational self-interest. They simply stole the money, smuggled it out through Kabul airport, and used it to buy luxury properties in Dubai. During this period, it was estimated that $10 million a day was being taken out of Afghanistan this way. The scandal seemed to confirm for many Afghans that the United States had not brought democracy or free markets to their country, but instead a corrupt crony capitalism that had taken over Afghanistan and its government. Which was the very same allegation that was being made against politicians at home, in America and in Britain. At the end of 2014, British soldiers left Afghanistan. All the bases were wiped out, as if nothing had been there. Even the war memorials were packed up and taken back to Staffordshire.